In an age where college funding is limited, education resources are questionable, and arts programs are being cut, the Coalition for African Americans in the Performing Arts, better known as CAAPA, has stepped up to the plate.
Inspired by CAAPA as a part of its commitment in supporting classical music education and performance artists throughout the United States and abroad, we offer the Masterclass series. CAAPA marries serious music students with acclaimed music masters of color, targeting historically black colleges and universities, or HBCUs, high school performing arts schools, and music conservatories, including schools like Howard University, Livingstone College, Morgan State University, Detroit School for the Arts, Morehouse College, Texas Southern University, Spelman College, University of Kentucky, and Winston-Salem State University.
The Masterclass series helps students build self-confidence, strengthen performances, hone their skills, tighten presentations, improve stage presence, work on technique, and vocal recommendations.
While emphasis is placed on classical music students to participate in the Masterclass series, audiences and faculty members are also encouraged to attend the free-to-the-public sessions, an exciting and fresh way to help CAAPA bring color to the classics.
The Coalition for African Americans in the Performing Arts, funded by the National Endowment of the Arts, with additional funding from the Prince George's County, Maryland, chapter of The Links Incorporated.
Hello, I'm Donna Graves, president of the Prince George's County, Maryland chapter of The Links Incorporated. On behalf of our 84 chapter members, I'm delighted to welcome you to this presentation by the Coalition for African Americans in the Performing Arts. The Links Incorporated was established in 1946 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and we're based on friendship and service. We are an international not-for-profit organization consisting of over 16,000 professional women of color in 292 chapters and located in 41 states, the District of Columbia, the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and the United Kingdom. The Prince George's County, Maryland chapter was chartered in March 1979, and for 42 years, our chapter has been dedicated to serving the citizens of Prince George's County, Maryland. Through our arts facet, we have a strong and rich history of supporting the performing and visual arts in Prince George's County and showcasing talented youth. Our chapter has a long-standing relationship with the Prince George's African American Museum and Cultural Center, and we have supported the orchestral performances of the Prince George's Philharmonic and visual arts programs at Bowie State University and Drew Freeman Middle School. We are delighted to extend our reach into the community through the partnership with the Coalition for African Americans in the Performing Arts. We hope you enjoy today's performance.
CAAPA, in partnership with Morgan State University, presents the Masterclass Series, the premier Black classical music masterclass series. Renowned for his interpretation of African American spirituals and folk songs, Robert Sims has received accolades from his performances throughout the United States, South America, Europe, Africa, Australia, and Asia. This season, he has appeared in Renée Baker's The James Baldwin Chronicles at Chicago's Symphony Center and with Chicago Opera Theater in the world premiere of Dan Shore's Freedom Ride. Sims has performed as a soloist with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir in the televised Songs from the Soul with Robert Sims, a heritage special. His solo recital at New York's Lincoln Center was titled The Spirituals of Roland Hayes and was narrated by George Shirley. Sims has worked with several composers and arrangers, including Lita McLean, David Baker, Moses Hogan, Roland Carter, Undine Smith Moore, and Jacqueline Hairston. Robert Sims was a gold medal winner of the American Traditions Competition, the Living Heritage Foundation Lifetime Achievement Award, and the Friends of Negro Spirituals Heritage Keepers Award. Mr. Sims is the donor of the Robert Sims Spiritual Prize for the George Shirley Vocal Competition. He is an alumnus of Oberlin Conservatory, SUNY Binghamton, Northwestern University, and Music Academy of the West. It is my esteemed pleasure to welcome baritone Robert Sims. Hello, everyone. Before we meet the music master, I would just like to say hello to everyone and welcome to the special spring edition of CAAPA's virtual masterclass series. My name is Angela Renee Simpson. I am the program director of the series and your host. I would like to thank Morgan State University and its music department for agreeing to partner with us today in bringing color to the classics. To the MSU music students and faculty who are observing via Zoom, we will have a short question and answer session after Mr. Sims finishes working with Mr. Washington. Please feel free to use the chat button for any questions you may have. And those who are watching on Facebook Live, please post your questions in the comments. Now, without further ado, I bring to you our music master, baritone Robert Sims, followed by MSU junior soprano Ms. Nazarene Maloney. Welcome, Mr. Sims. Thank you for attending. You may begin.
Well, good morning for some, good afternoon for others. It's a pleasure to be here. I've been on the campus of Morgan State University, and today we're here virtually, and it's always a pleasure and such a pleasure to work with CAAPA. We're doing wonderful things, and I'm just honored and privileged to be a part of that organization. All right, Ms. Nazarene Maloney, are we ready?
Yes, sir.
Will you announce your song and the arranger, and let's start, let's begin.
Today I will be performing Pomona Got a Home at Last, arranged by Holly Johnson. Preacher, preacher,
Nazarene, that was wonderful. That was really fantastic. You really have a wonderful feeling. What a beautiful voice. What a beautiful sound. And you have a great feeling for this repertoire, which one shouldn't take for granted because not everyone does. Tell me something about Hall Johnson.
So Hall Johnson is one of a few Black composers who actually made it in America doing spirituals. I know that he did start off in violin rather than choral music, but I believe when he traveled to New York, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe when he traveled to New York, he put together his own choir and they began traveling the country doing shows. They were actually in the Song of the South for Walt Disney, and during that time, along with his choral arrangements, he did art songs and wrote many art songs. They have a few books with his repertoire in it, and they even have entire competitions named after him.
You know what? This is why I love CAAPA and love Morgan. You are so prepared. That is so right. He was from Georgia, grew up in Athens, Georgia, a violinist. The Hall Johnson Chorale performed everywhere. He was a wonderful coach and coached one of the great sopranos of our time, Miss Shirley Verrett. Mm. But he not only coached her in spirituals, he coached her in German Lieder. He was a master in German Lieder. And we can see that he really studied the art song and really studied Lieder. We can see that in his interpretations of his arrangements of these spirituals. They are masterpieces. And so he has taken us further than Burleigh. Burleigh started, you know, Burleigh we credit with being the first composer to take the spiritual to the concert stage for the solo singer, the arranged solo spiritual for piano and voice. And Burleigh also did art songs. Hall Johnson even developed that concert spiritual, even took us even further with that. Fantastic. He died in a fire in his home in Manhattan. There was music and papers just everywhere, and he smoked a lot. And people, when they would go visit him, the great composer Roland Carter, who's composing and with us, said he went to visit him, and he said, "This man is going to set himself on fire smoking with all this music and all that around here." Well, we don't know if he was responsible for the fire, but he did die in a fire in his home. Fantastic. Just prepared and beautifully sung. If your pianist was there live, I would take this a little bit slower to find that backbeat of the spiritual. But during a pandemic, we're working and doing the best that we can. If you could give me one word about this spiritual, one word, what would that word be?
Plaintive.
I like that. Try this one. Surrender. Ooh. Surrender. Mona, Seeker, and even the preacher who's supposed to be leading the flock over everybody. Why don't you just fall down on your knees? Why don't you surrender and join the angels? Woo! No harm. No harm. What does no harm mean?
No pain, no mourning, no sorrow.
The Bible verses for this spiritual are Psalms 105, 14 and 15, and Chronicles 16, 1 Chronicles 16, verses 21 and 22. And that is, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm.
Jesus.
Yeah. No harm, brother. So once the mourner has come to the mourner's bench and he has dedicated his life, he has become one of God's anointed, and God says, do my prophets no harm. All right? And who are we going to tell about it? We're going to tell Elijah about it. Elijah was so anointed that he didn't have to die. What happened? They sent down a fiery chariot and took him on up with the angels. That ought to just make you want to just shout and run all over your house. Now sing it again. Stop you. That is so classical and so well trained, but the enslaved African would take a breath after the first no harm. Oh, no harm. And he said again, no harm, no harm. Tell Brother Elijah, no harm, no harm. Mona got a home. Yeah, he gave his life to Christ and he got a home at last. A home not built with hands. Whoa, tell Brother Elijah. And the first time, the thing that is so wonderful about the spiritual is that it is so repetitive. The challenging thing for us is that we have to find a different color every time we say it. So maybe no harm, the second time, no harm. You have to work with those words and be able to say them five different ways and five different colors and five different dynamics. So work with that. You might wanna start softer, or you might want to and then build, but we have to work with all those colors. All right, let's start from the top. Very good. Let's stop that. Let's stop that again. Now, see, that's where I would tell your pianist to slow down if he was there live, because he's not giving you room to breathe.
Yeah.
He's just honing in on that rhythm, and you need no harm, no harm, no harm. You need some room, and so we're working in an interesting situation. This is good practice. There might be a conductor that doesn't give you room. Okay, so let's work with it. Sometimes you'll even go into the studio. I remember those recordings that I did with Moses Hogan, some of the very first recordings. Moses had already recorded the piano tracks. So I had to go in and sing. He was there conducting me in the studio, but he had recorded, the piano tracks were laid. And that's important, because at least the piano tracks were perfect. Then we could get me as close to perfection as we could, because when two people are working live, my performance might be great, the piano might mess up, then we got to do it again. The piano might mess up and I might be great. So it's good to get each track. So your piano track is down. This is good practice for you. You never know what you might encounter in a professional situation. Let's do it again, but get that breath in there. No harm, no harm. And if you don't get that M on harm, doesn't matter. We left off syllables all the time. Why did we leave off syllables? Is because in most African languages, it didn't end with a consonant. In most African languages, like Italian, our words ended with a vowel. So we're no harm, no harm, no harm. If you don't even breathe, give an idea of a breath. No harm, no. But take that breath. No harm, no harm. Tell Brother Elijah. And see, we don't say Elijah. We just say Brother Elijah. All right? And enjoy saying Brother Elijah. All right? Let's take it again. For that na, it might get away from you. Look, mona, don't go vertical. Don't go mona, it could leave you in the same place as the mona. Mona, just drop your jaw for na. All right, start on that mona, and then and look, the strong beat is always on one. Mona, Mona, ain't you tired of mourning? It's always on one, all right, in this, since we're in cut time, and. And so don't stress that O so much. Oh, Mona, go to Mona. O is not that important, and. Very good. Now, don't slam the mona. Let's do what the Italians say. It's an appoggio, appoggiarsi, with lean on it. Oh, mona. Don't slam it. Lean on it, pull on the body. Oh, mona. Pull on the body. Don't slam. We never slam. All right? Appoggiarsi, appoggio.
Appoggio.
Appoggio, appoggiarsi, just means to lean. Lean on your support. You don't never have to slam your voice. Lean on the support. Mona, and stay in that, stay in that. Mona, no, Mona. Don't go wide. And. Everybody's going to think you're saying, and join the battle with the angels. And join the band, or with the band, or with the angels. And join the band, or with the doesn't go with band. It goes with a with. And join the band, or with the angels. And he has the band, join the band, oh, with the angel. I will put the band, it is, I will put the band with the wid.
Okay.
Join the band, oh, with the angel. And because when you do it with the other, it sounds like battle. Join the battle with the banner with the angels. All right, work that out so it doesn't sound like battle, okay? The band, or with the angels. And John, look at me. Look at me, and John, not enjoin, and John, okay? Yeah, very good, and you still slam that mono, oh, mon, just push out on the body, oh, mon, just lean in on the body, don't slam it, and.
Oh,
Very good. Don't let that S take you off your voice. Oh, see. Don't let the S take you off your voice. Oh, seeker. Just oh, seeker. Very good. Three verses, you have to know that the preacher, he's the biggest one. So it's the mourner first, the seeker. So you can't give it all for the mourner, and you can't give it all for the seeker. You got to, preacher, even you're not an exception. Preacher, you need to surrender too. Because although you get up every Sunday morning and tell us what to do, and thus saith the Lord, you need to surrender as well. Mm-hmm. God has no respecter of persons. All of you need to surrender and join the band or with the angels. Now, Hall Johnson has banna, but then he has that apostrophe after band, which would be the band. Band or with the angels. Figure out how you can make it work so it doesn't sound like it could be banna. Banner or ban or with the angels, ban or with the angels, but so it doesn't sound like battle. Very good. Each no harm, you have that little harm, you can work with that so that it's different each time. No harm, no harm, each time that yada-da, those little blues notes can be different because you sing a no harm so much. Every time it's got to be a different color, a different dynamic, something to keep it interesting. Five minutes, Mr. Sims. Every verse, Mona, then Seeker, then the last one, Preacher, has to be the biggest one. Mm-hmm. And then, because you said it the second time, let's go on with Preacher so I can hear you just moan that hum, all right? Hall Johnson doesn't like you to add anything, so don't add anything on home. Oh, mon, oh, God, oh, And just press the home. Just do the H. Oh, Mona got a home. What more could he ask for? A home not made with hands. A home in the protective arms of God. Oh, Mona got a home. You don't have to add a note. You don't have to add anything because it's all there. All right? That's the main thing. He surrendered and now he has. And then you're humming. And then you just get so filled. You say, oh, my Lord. And then you hum some more. Oh, Mona got a hole. And by the time you finish this, after all I've given you, the church won't be ready. They'll just fall out. It'd be really, really fantastic. And you have to have. William Dawson taught me every spiritual. That's how you know the tempo. Just so the old ladies can rock in the first row. The deacons, yeah, everybody's rocking with you. If everybody's not rocking with you, it's not right. And in any spiritual, you ought to be able to throw a hallelujah in there. Don't throw it in there, but that's going to let you know the rhythm. No ha, no ha, no ha, da. Hallelujah, no. If that hallelujah is not right, that means the rhythm ain't right. Hey, I don't know who taught me that. Hallelujah, no, huh? If the hallelujah isn't in there, if that hallelujah feels rushed or whatever, the tempo's not right. All right, start on your hum, and it's a moan. It's not a hum, it's a moan, and. Yeah, I'm sorry. You know, just moan, 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 moan. Don't stop it when I talk. Just keep moaning, and. Oh yes. Yeah, and if we weren't with a track, you could take that even small, stronger. That rallentando doesn't start on God. The rallentando would start. Rallentando would start right at the beginning of that measure. Pomona God, a home at last. You can put that rallentando over that whole three bars. All right. Mm-hmm. Brava.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Keep working with it. There's much more there than you could ever have imagined. Sometimes we think this spiritual, oh, it's simple. We throw it away. It's as much in there as there is in Schubert's The Erl King. There's a lot in there. All right. See you. Fantastic.
Thank you, Ms. Maloney. Next, we have MSU freshman baritone, Mr. Jeremiah Washington.
Hi.
Hello there. Oh, you dress for the occasion. You look wonderful, young man. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Tell us what you're singing and who you're singing, and tell me a little bit about Burleigh. If you were watching the first half, I told you something about him, but tell me a little bit more.
So I'm singing My Lord, What a Morning by H.T. Burleigh. And from my research, he was one of the first African-American artists to come up after the Civil War. And I know he grew up in church singing, and things like that.
He grew up in church singing. You all make me so proud. Tell me, you know a little bit more about Burleigh?
From Pennsylvania. I don't know how to pronounce the first part.
Yes. Erie, Pennsylvania. Keep going.
That was it. I'll do more research.
No, fantastic. He was a baritone like you. He was a singer. And we credit him as being the first to write, arrange spirituals for voice and piano for the concert stage. And then everybody, white and black singers alike, were performing his arrangements. Roland Hayes, most notably, was doing Burleigh arrangements. And so he was a singer and composer, wonderful pianist, fine organist. He went to the National Conservatory and was inspired by Dvorak. Dvorak was there and he heard Burleigh spirituals and he said, this should be the national music of America. It's so interesting that it took a European to recognize the brilliance of this music of enslaved Africans. And it's so interesting that today we are, some of us, because out of the history from which this music has come, can be kind of ashamed of it. But this European said, hey, this should be the national school. All American music should be built on this. And that was really extraordinary. He was an editor for Ricordi Publishing that published all the Italian scores and all that. So he was able to get his spirituals published, and which was fantastic, by a major publisher. All right, my Lord, what a morning. Let's hear you, young man. Fantastic.
Thank you.
A gorgeous instrument. You're a freshman there. And you all, well, you know, all the singers at Morgan, they just go to the Met and sing all over the world. And so you're just in a great tradition of great singing that goes on there. You're so well prepared and your voice is gorgeous. I know you're going to do great, great things in the future. I'm looking forward to hearing from you and from Miss Maloney, because you all, this is fantastic. It really does something for me this morning. Wonderful. Tell me a little bit about this spiritual.
I more pay attention to the text, like word-wise.
Talk to me about the text.
So it's My Lord, What a Morning. So what I try to embody is just being grateful, you know, waking up another day and thanking God for another morning. So my Lord, what a morning. And, you know, I enjoy taking walks. So I know I say that spiritually in my mind, my Lord, what a morning. So I try to embody just gratefulness in this piece.
Fantastic. That comes through and that's beautiful. Did you look at the top of your music? It has Revelations 8, verse 10. Did you ever look that up?
I didn't.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what's so interesting about it is that when you look it up, Revelations 8, verse 10, we know John the Revelator, there were all of these visions that he had. And this was a vision about, what can I say, disasters happening on the earth. And it was about seven angels, and then there was a third angel and all of that. And so I don't know how helpful it was, but it was about a star falling. So I don't know how helpful that text would be. We'd have to study that text a little bit more and maybe look at different interpretations of that text. And one thing that would be very good is to look at what metaphysical interpretations of that text might be, going even further to interpret these dreams of John the Revelator. But quite often, these spirituals had an alternate meaning. And so instead of my Lord, what a beautiful morning, my Lord, what a morning, M-O-U-R, we're mourning.
Mm.
When you're mourning something, my Lord, what a morning. When the stars begin to fall, the stars are those leaders that were killed. The stars are those people that were trying to rescue or help enslaved Africans, when those people began to die. And I don't know if you've had this experience or not, but quite often when someone passes away and they die and you try to get some sleep that night and you wake up the next morning, that's when it really hits you the next morning that they are no longer here. When the stars, when the people that light up your life begin to fall. And I done quit all my worldly ways. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to quit all my worldly ways. I'm going to join the heavenly band. Now, here's this thing. So we can think of these two ways. And most people think of this as, my Lord, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a wonderful feeling. Everything's going my way. I would ask you to possibly change your idea about this to, my Lord, what a morning. What a morning.
Okay.
What a morning. And also, the hard thing about that is that unaccented syllable morning is on the long note, so we have to figure out a way to deal with that. My Lord, what a morning. Don't stress that. Morning, don't stress that. So we put a stress on Lord. My Lord, what a morning. So if we stress that first beat, strong beat, spiritual in 4-4 time, like the blues, the strong beats are on 1 and 3. My Lord, what a morning. My Lord, what a morning. All right, let's take it from the beginning. And good work. What a gorgeous, easy, free, natural, just matched up tone, gorgeous voice, just gorgeous. And
from Indiana, but I currently live in Maryland.
You're from Indiana, okay. I understand that. Any relatives from the South?
Yes.
Who?
My grandmother.
Grandmama.
Yeah.
Okay. And I wonder if grandmother says my lord, or does she say my lord?
My lord.
My lord. Difference. My lord. My lord. My lord.
My lord.
Say that for me, kind of. Sylvia Odin Lee was just a master at this. She would say, you got to say it like Aunt Hattie. My lord. My lord. What a morning. Let me, and could you say that for me?
My lord. What a morning.
You're so proper from Indiana. My lord. My lord.
My lord.
Oh, I like that. Just relax it a little bit. It's so different. It's so interesting for me, who sings a lot of spirituals. And when I go back and sing the Messiah or an art song in English, I have to put all of my my's have to go to my, and I have to put all my final consonants on because I'm so used to taking them off in the spiritual, a different language. My, let's just try that again, a little bit more relaxed English. My Lord, what a morning, what a morning.
Okay. I'm sorry to interrupt, but Mr. Washington, if you can turn your music just down, just a tad, we're getting a little bit of feedback.
So don't make it so wide like grandmama. Ma, Lord. Keep that same round sound you had, vertical, not wide, but don't put that diphthong on. My, just leave the diphthong off. Ma, Lord, not my Lord, but don't go wide, all right? But very good attempt, very good. And I don't want the dialect to take you away from that gorgeous sound that you had in the beginning. So let me just be clear. I don't want this, my Lord. I don't want that. I want that same beautiful sound you had, my Lord. But I don't want you to go, my Lord. Just take the diphthong off. My Lord, not my or my. But stay that same long, gorgeous sound you had in the beginning. Just take the diphthong off, Anne, all right? Anne. You know what I mean when I say diphthong?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Long sound, my lord.
My lord.
Good.
My lord, what a morning.
That a morning.
My lord, what a morning. Oh,
accent duh. Don't, you're speaking in a dialect, but don't bring attention to the duh. Wind a star, not wind a star, no. Wind a stars. Okay, let's just take wind a stars and now keep it there, keep saying.
Oh, my Lord, what a morning.
Repeat something, it's got to be different the second time. So the second, my Lord, the second time you come with my Lord, sempre legato, more legato, pull the taffy even more. You know what taffy is?
Yes.
Pull that taffy to my Lord, even softer, but more legato than the first time, okay, to make it different. And the second verse is marked, the repeat on my Lord, water morning is marked piano. Then when you get to done, quit all my worldly ways, get rid of that T, done, quit, no. Done quit all of my worldly ways. All right. Join that heavenly band, not heavenly. Join that heavenly band, heavenly band. The start of that done quit. We don't need the accompaniment for it. Just take that B flat. Done quit and.
Done quit all my.
Stay in the space of that don. Don quit. Just change your tongue. You don't have to close it down. Don quit. Let me see here those two words. And.
Don quit.
Good. Don't close your mouth. Don quit. Just raise your tongue. And.
Don quit.
Good. Don quit all of my. And.
Don quit all my worldly ways. Join a heavenly band.
Good.
Done quit all my worldly ways.
Yes, and we need to make music with that, and you can do it. Done quit all of my world. And.
Done quit all my.
Don't squeeze that quit. Don quit. Just use the tongue, keep the same space, and.
Don quit all my worldly ways. Join that heavenly band. Don quit all my worldly ways. Join that heavenly band.
So the reason I say hum, the B and the hmm, b, 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 there's a little hum before, b. All of my worldly ways, join that heavenly, heavenly, heavenly band, heavenly.
5 minutes, Mr. Sims, 5 minutes.
Yes, band. So let me hear that done quit all my worldly ways. And then he gives you all of these different notes to do something when you say done quit all my worldly ways a second time. And we have to make those notes make musical and emotional sense, not singing them just because they're notes on the page. You're doing very well. Do the first done quit all my worldly ways. Done quit. Give yourself the B flat.
You said it's the second one, correct?
Go on.
It's the second one, or am I doing the first?
The first one.
Done quit all my worldly ways, join that heavenly band.
Done quit.
Done quit all my worldly ways, join that heavenly band.
Different. Now he did my Lord differently that time. Yes, make something of it. Oh my Lord. Let's hear that, Anne.
Oh my Lord, what a morning.
Go on.
My Lord, what a morning.
Now, you know those that last page, my Lord, what a morning, he goes down. My Lord, what a Lord, what a Lord. Make something of that. Oh, my Lord. And.
Oh, my Lord, what a morning.
Now look at me. Morning, morning. Morning. I kept the same mouth position. I just changed the tongue. When I don't go ing, I go in. My Lord. And.
My Lord, what a morning. My Lord, what a morning.
Morning.
Morning. Oh, I see. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Morning, oh my Lord, what a morning.
Anna.
When does the
last one, my Lord, what a morning. When on that fermata, and.
My Lord, what a morning.
You sing ing, and I'd like you to sing in. I'd like you to sing an I and not an E. I, as an in. He's going into the store. And.
My Lord.
And my Lord.
My Lord, what a morning. When does the...
And even for the wind, let the wind be long. When. Yes.
When does the stars begin to
milk the F and
fall.
And you don't have to put that L on so soon, just at the very end. To fall. And
to fall.
That is a gorgeous instrument. And you are so smart and so talented, and hang in there. I see something wonderful for you, and you and Nazarene, just tremendous, really wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Washington and Ms. Maloney. Beautiful, beautiful voices. Beautiful instruments. It was lovely, lovely to watch. Now we have our question and answer session. If you would like to ask a question of Mr. Sims, please, if you're watching on the Zoom, please post it in the chat. If you would like to ask a question or on the Facebook, please post your question in the comments. And we would love to hear from anyone. So Mr. Sims, let's talk about your affinity with Negro spirituals. We didn't get a chance to talk about that last time you were here. What started you on the journey?
I was fortunate enough to have as my one of my very first voice teachers, Lena McLean, Dr. Lena McLean, who taught so many of us, me, Mark Rucker, Jonita Lattimore, Nicole Houston, Mandy Patinkin on Broadway, Chaka Khan, you know, all of these singers. And she had this gift of knowing where you should be. You know, she wouldn't let me sing pop music. You know, I was going to sing, you know, classical music. And I think Nicole Houston wanted to sing pop. And she was like, no, you're going to be an opera singer. And so, she worked with Jennifer Hudson. She worked with everybody and just a great musician. Wow. The niece of Thomas A. Dorsey, she introduced me to the spiritual. And one of the first ones she talked about was My Lord, What a Morning, and telling me that it wasn't about the beautiful sunshiny day. And so it was a different interpretation of that spiritual for me. Mm-hmm. I was just fortunate enough to have her. And when you go to college, you can't, you know, major in the spiritual. So, you know, I sang Mozart and Brahms and Schubert and Haydn and Vaughan Williams and all of the art songs that we all do, just like you. You know, it's so funny when people see us on the stage doing Gershwin or Porgy and Bess or whatever, you don't develop a line to sing My Man's Gone Now without having sung Strauss or and it was so interesting that people can hear us singing Gershwin and say, well, I wonder if they can sing. Nobody woke up singing Gershwin, and if you really knew how difficult it was, of course they can sing Strauss,
right? Absolutely.
And Mozart, you know, we didn't grow up singing Porgy and Bess like that,
right?
People just think it's a natural. No. So gotta have some technique to sing that. And so I just found this love, and then when I started teaching in academia, I found that I couldn't be gone a lot doing opera, but I could leave doing spiritual concerts on the weekend. I could do recitals.
Yes.
And so it just grew out of that.
And wonderful. Not very people think about making a career out of recital. You can have a lovely career doing recital as opposed to opera productions.
Right. One has to really, I was fortunate, but as a young singer, I was just very ambitious. Mm-hmm. And I remember writing all these managers, and I wrote community concerts, and I just won the American Traditions competition. And I wrote them, I said, I won this competition. And such and such, like most managers would say, who cares, right?
Yeah.
They gave me about 100 community concerts singing all around the United States. And yeah. I chose full concerts of spirituals. And so that was just thrilling. And, you know, I'd write conductors, I'd find their address and write them and send them my tapes. They were like, who is this kid?
Well, hey, look, you, if you're ready, you don't have to get ready. If you're always ready, you don't have to get ready. That's what I say.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful. Please, anyone, if you have any questions, this is a valuable, valuable asset here to ask any questions you have of Mr. Sims. You can post them in the chat or post them on Facebook Live. So let me ask you this, now that we're hopefully on the upside of this COVID situation, as far as the students are concerned, students who are now in school, what do you suggest that they what they do, how to prepare for the upcoming freedoms we're about to have?
I have to say, these students, I love going to Morgan. They are so, weren't they fantastic?
Yeah, absolutely.
You
absolutely.
Know, Marquita gets them together. They are, yes. And
you're going to see her in a few minutes.
There. I've done classes for them there, and just one after another, and they are prepared. That just makes our job as a master teacher just so easy.
Absolutely.
And it inspires us to see somebody ready. You know, that is wonderful. And that's not going on everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so we do have a question.
Okay.
This is from, Regine. I hope that I'm saying her name correct, Regine Hill. Do you think there is a space to teach English diction of the Black vernacular in the academic setting, similarly to how we learn Italian, French, and German diction?
I don't know if we need an entire class. I do teach English diction at the university where I've been for 27 years, Northern Illinois University. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I do in that class, I have them watch the Leonard Bernstein documentary of West Side Story, the recording. And the reason that I do that is because here's a musical conducted by Bernstein where the soprano, Kiri Takanawa, is British, and she's singing the part of a Puerto Rican, Maria. And then you have the Spanish, Jose Carreras, and he's singing the part of, he's singing what is his name? I don't know, the lead.
Tony.
Singing Tony. Mm-hmm. And so, and they have their accents, you know? Right. And I also have my English diction students watch different recordings, different performances of Porgy and Bess. Mm-hmm. So Sushil Bibbs has a wonderful book out on the spiritual, and I was able to do some work with her, and I said, hey, why don't we put some IPA in your book that talks about dialect? And it's a little booklet, but the knowledge in there is just so fantastic. So I recommend people go on Amazon and get that book. And we talk about the dialect, which is very, very, it's a very, very personal thing. You have to work with the dialect so that it fits on your tongue in a natural way, and that it is, that it's relaxed. Because if it's accented in any way, that dialect, if you make the dialect stick out, it can border on becoming making fun of it, like a minstrel kind of thing. And that's something we definitely want to stay away from. We don't want to accent those dim do's and do's and all of that, and they're so accented that it sounds like we're making fun of the language. Right. And you also have to understand that the reason that the dialect is written is that there wasn't a TH in the African languages. The reason that there was, we don't put the final consonants on is because most of our words in African languages ended in vowels, like the Italian language. Mm-hmm. And so there are reasons for all of this. Mm-hmm. Some of the mispronounced words were because we heard them from the not so educated overseers. Right. There was also German influences in our languages. Mm-hmm. So one shouldn't look upon it as this was done out of ignorance. There was a reason for this language, and just like there's a reason for a Milanese dialect or a Sicilian dialect, and we sing in dialects all the time. Right. And so this is an African American dialect, and it should be respected as best as possible. Although I believe this music is for everyone, I think white people, when they choose a spiritual, they can also have a Southern, more relaxed kind of delivery, but we don't want their delivery to border on minstrelsy.
Right, absolutely. Next question is from Dr. Lester Green. Any strategies you recommend for singers singing spirituals who have English as a second language?
Ah, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. We just have to get them as close to vowels that they understand in their language. Mm-hmm. And listening. I think it's just like we all have learned Italian, French, and German, and Russian.
Yes.
And then just coaching. But the wonderful thing about music and the wonderful thing about the spiritual, what speaks louder than anything is sincerity. Sincerity.
That's true.
And that will, and heart. Sincerity and heart, which means the same thing. That will forgive a million sins. Mm-hmm. You know, just come from the heart, and it will be right. But what's so challenging, and challenging for me as well, is we get so caught up in the technical aspects of making this instrument a vibrating, projecting instrument. But just making this instrument a resonant instrument that will carry. We get so tied up in the technical aspects mm-hmm. that we leave out the heart. Mm-hmm. One of the things about the spiritual is that it will take you, it immediately takes you to the heart of the situation. Absolutely. That's why Black singers like Marian Anderson could sing, "Oh, rest in the Lord, wait patiently for him." Why? Because she heard her preacher talking about it on Sunday mornings, mm-hmm. and she knows something about, "Oh, rest in the Lord, mm-hmm. wait patiently for him, and he shall give you the desires of your heart." And it just rest. And Black folks been resting a long time on the Lord. And what was so wonderful about it, when the verdict came down, we didn't know how it was going to come. You knew I was going to go there, Angela. See, that's why they don't want me on the show. Okay. They say, don't bring him on the show. But we have been resting, child, resting for a while. Well. And folks telling us that our lives didn't mean anything. Well. And we can snuff you out and it doesn't matter. But when the verdict came down, we had been resting on the Lord. And for one time they said, "Ho, we can't let this one go."
Well, I'm gonna leave that there. But I'm gonna leave that right there.
Don't get me started.
Well, let's go on to the next question. Okay. So Hakeem Henderson would like to know, what do you believe a person should do to be successful in opera post-COVID?
Well, hopefully you've been practicing your scale. When COVID was going on, there was this famous piano teacher, and they said he was the best piano teacher in the United States. Mm-hmm. His name was Donald Walker. And everybody at Juilliard was saying he was one of the best to study with. And he had on his door one thing: practice your scale. Well, you know, that makes very good sense, because if you practice that scale, and it evens everything out, and it can go up and it can go down and it can go on different. Hey, right. Hopefully you've been practicing your scale. Yeah. So now that things open up, you can get out there and sing and apply the discipline of that scale to your Mozart aria, and hopefully your voice is rested, and you can get out there and just do your best.
And the playing field is level.
Yes. If you're African American, the time is now. You better get out there and try to do it now, because they might forget about all this in 2 years.
Don't get me started. Okay. Dr. Green also has another question. Actually, I think he's answering that now, but he said a different question. People of European descent often avoid singing this repertoire. How do we invite them into this space to explore this repertoire?
Sing it from your heart. Mm-hmm. Now, I am not interested in someone of European descent getting up there singing, "Mama, is Massa gonna sell us tomorrow?" That is not appropriate for you. But you can sing, "My Lord, What a Morning," when the stars begin to fall. You know that. Mm-hmm. You can sing, "I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord." Mm-hmm. You can sing, "Glory, glory, hallelujah, when I lay my burdens down." You know something about some burdens. Right. Well, if you don't, somebody else. You can sing all this stuff that means, "I want to be a Christian in my heart." Mm-hmm. You can sing all these things that means something to you. You don't have to go and sing, "Mama, is Master gonna sell us tomorrow?" Because you might not make it out the concert hall. Wait, I'm being bad this morning.
Okay, on to the next question. Okay, go ahead, finish what you're going to say.
No. the director's going to kick me out of Capitol.
Okay. Well,
go on.
Mr. Robert Cantrell, he asks, how do you deal with stage fright and nervousness when performing? How does one combat this? Because many performers suffer from it. Sometimes it derails the preparation one has done for a performance.
Roland Hayes, the father of African American concert singers. He inspired Marian Anderson and everything. Roland Hayes had a very unique instrument. It wasn't a big instrument, but what he delivered. And Roland Hayes' secret is, and sometimes I forget it, but his prayer was, Lord, blot out Roland Hayes so that they only see thee. And they say that the audience was transfixed. The audience they didn't know what hit him. This short black man dressed to the nines coming out there singing, leader and everything else. And so if we just surrender, and I don't, you know, I'm the doors open and I'm thinking, oh boy, I gotta walk out there and the sinuses are doing this and this is doing that. And I don't know how well the rehearsal, if I could just surrender and say, Lord, take the wheel. Lord, let Robert Sims go and let them only see thee. Shoot, the folks will be laid out. But sometimes I forget.
Well, we're only human.
Sometimes I forget.
Okay, we have one more question. What advice? This is from Mr. Stephen Jones. What advice do you have to young performers in these times of uncertainty?
You know, this whole idea of singing. My voice teacher yesterday always has wonderful, wonderful things. I was working with him yesterday and he said, what happened to the joy of singing? That's interesting, isn't it? What happened to the joy of singing? And Leontine Price talks about that.
Oh yeah, I was that last quote went right through my head.
And that's why her singing was so infectious. You know, I work with many people, and they have said that to me in different ways. You can't let the joy go. Yeah, the joy.
Absolutely,
that's hard. So sing with joy. And that will go with you a very, very long way.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. That's 100% truth. All right. Well, thank you for those questions, answering those questions for us. We would like to bring on Ms. Marquita Lister, the coordinator of vocal studies at MSU, if she can jump on, if she has a few words.
Hello, everyone. And my wonderful friend, Robert, as always, incredible, wonderful. And you are hilariously funny. I have to tell you, I was falling out of my chair as you were saying some things. And I certainly am 100% behind everything that you said. It was just wonderful. Thank you for your pearls of wisdom. And Angela, of course, it's great to see you. Angela Simpson, if you all don't know, is also a wonderful singer. And she and I have worked together many times. And so it's nice to see her again. And to our two Morgan singers that sang, bravo, brava. You represented us well, and we're so proud of you. And I appreciate CAAPA also giving us this masterclass. So thank you very much.
Marquita, where do you get these fantastic singers? And I'm sure they're aware of the tradition of Morgan, of all these great singers going on and having these international careers coming from Morgan. Do they just flood there because of the reputation of all these singers? The two that I heard today are fantastic.
Absolutely.
Well, you know, I always say there's something in the water because we have so many young singers that try so hard. And, you know, we have, like in any school, you have your really, really, really exceptional students. And then we also have students that are just very, very good. We all love working with them. And I wish that people really understood that we have such a wonderful voice faculty. I mean, the entire faculty is outstanding and we care about our students and we want them to do well and we want them to succeed. And that is, I think, the main mission behind our program is that we want you to feel like we care about you. And I think that also helps in the learning process, is that they know that we want them to be the very best that they can possibly be. And whatever that is, if you want to be a musical theater singer, if you want to be an opera singer, whatever your joy, that using your word, Robert, because that's also a very important, is the joyfulness of the singing. What is going to be the air beneath your wings to keep you going as you go through your education process, but in life in general? Because if you don't love the singing, then why do it? Mm-hmm. Because it may for sure that when you get out into the business of it all, as you know, Robert, and you also, Angela, you know, there are going to be many more no's than yeses. And so if you don't love it, you can't keep going through all the no's to get to that yes, you know? And then once you get that yes, then it spurs you on to keep working, to keep trying, to keep moving on to the next job. So I think that for us, I hope that we have a reputation that makes singers want to come to us because they know that we're going to try to help them accomplish their goal, to get where they want to go. No matter where that is, we're going to stay in there with them, you know? So I feel very happy to be at Morgan, and I feel very blessed to have the voice faculty members that I have. We all get along so well, and we have like minds and so many things. We call ourselves the Sing Team, and we call ourselves that for a reason, because we work as a team. We really do. We look over each other's students. Mm-hmm. We're not territorial or anything like that. We don't like to have a lot of competition among the studios. We just want everyone to feel like they have a place with us.
That's wonderful.
That's wonderful.
Well, thank you so much. Mr. Sims, we'll give you the last words. Would you have some parting words for us?
Yes. During this time, I just want to give a shout out to CAAPA, who has been so wonderful in supporting artists and in educating artists. And during this pandemic, CAAPA was really supportive of all of their artists, which I think was fantastic, going into the schools and encouraging young people with top-notch artists with international careers is just really extraordinary. What you have done, what Terry has done, what the entire team has done is just really, there's nothing like it. And where other people are pulling back, I'm so happy that CAAPA is pushing forward.
Thank you.
Just really a blessing. And we could see what happened with these young people today. They were so prepared and they just were able to accept what I had to give because they were prepared.
Absolutely.
And so it was a pleasure for me. I never know what I'm going to say and what I do, in these classes. I always try to be prepared. Mm-hmm. And but you know, you never know what the artist is going to bring, the young artist is going to bring. And so it's a learning experience for me. And mm-hmm. I'm just happy to be in the number. Still here doing what I'm doing. And you know, I'll let out some good notes and and just keeping on. And to the spirituals, I wasn't prepared that they were going to do all spirituals today. Whatever they decided to do was fine with me, but mm-hmm. I'm happy that we're celebrating the spiritual. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you so much. So this concludes our special spring edition of CAAPA's virtual masterclass with Morgan State University. I hope everyone enjoyed the masterclass and took away some valuable, valuable information from Mr. Sims. CAAPA would like to thank the Prince George's County, Maryland chapter of the Links program as our special sponsor for today's virtual masterclass, MSU Music Department Chair, Dr. Eric Conway, Coordinator of Vocal Studies, Ms. Marquita Lister, Ms. Maloney, Mr. Washington, and last but not least, Mr. Robert Sims. We at CAAPA look forward to bringing you more masterclasses this fall, so keep a lookout for upcoming announcements in the spring and the summer. If you are interested in having a CAAPA virtual masterclass series partner with your institution, please stay and watch our exiting video, which will have all of our contact information. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Have a wonderful day, and God bless.